Up to now, in our study of stellar corpses, we've learned of some pretty extreme places. If you can believe it, we're not done yet. Neutron stars are not the final story when it comes to stellar remnants. But black holes are. The final story in more ways than one. Black holes are the most extreme objects in the universe. They're a one-way trip. If you enter, you can never get out. You can't even call for help. And by the way, once inside, time stands still. Next, we'll talk about these bizarre objects and the surprises that we have in store. Stay tuned. This table summarizes the end stages of stars that we've covered so far. We know that mass determines the star's fate. White dwarf stars' mass ranges from the lower limit of stellar cores up to 1.4 solar masses, the Chandrasekhar limit. Electron degeneracy prevents our star from getting hot enough to fuse carbon. But stars can be bigger. Beyond 1.4 solar masses, our star continues to collapse and can fuse carbon and heavier elements. A neutron star has to be heavier than 1.4 solar masses. But is there a maximum size? Can neutron degeneracy, like electron degeneracy, be overcome? In fact, yes. As strong as neutron degeneracy is, it's no match for gravity. Neutron degeneracy can be overcome when our core reaches a mass of about 3 solar masses. This limit is called the Tolman-Oppenheimer-Volkoff limit, often just referred to as the Oppenheimer-Volkoff limit. Once neutron degeneracy is overcome, can anything else prevent gravity from further collapse? Simply put, no. Our object then becomes a gravitationally completely collapsed object, as physicist John Wheeler originally called it. Having grown tired of saying this so many times, he shortened it to simply black holes. With nothing to stop our collapse, the star shrinks to zero size, zero volume, and infinite density. In spite of their apparent nothingness, they do have their own anatomy. The point where the mass is concentrated is called the singularity, the point of zero volume and infinite density. The black hole continues to have mass, but remember, it must be greater than 3 solar masses. If there's mass, there's an escape velocity. Escape velocity depends only on the mass of the object and the distance from its center, in this case, the singularity. Due to the large mass and extreme compactness of the black hole, the escape velocity can be quite large. In fact, the event horizon defines the point where the escape velocity is equal to the speed of light, the universe's maximum speed limit. The distance from the singularity to the event horizon is the Schwarzschild radius. It can be seen from this equation. R sub s depends only on the mass of the object. That means that every object has a Schwarzschild radius, even you. More on this to come. As an interesting side note, Karl Schwarzschild seemed destined to discover this property. His name in German literally translates to black barrier. With this background, it's important to clear up a common misconception about black holes. You often hear something like the following: black holes are so massive that not even light can escape. This is very imprecise and somewhat misleading. Galaxies have a very large mass, in fact millions of solar masses, and are not themselves black holes. The largest galaxy to date is the El Gordo galaxy. It too is a galaxy and not a black hole, although many, if not most, galaxies may contain black holes in their cores. To be more precise, a black hole is an object that is compressed so severely that its entire mass is contained within its Schwarzschild radius. The Earth, too, can be made a black hole by shrinking it to the size of 18 millimeters. The Sun, shrunk to a diameter of 6 kilometers, too, will have an escape velocity of c. In other words, it will be a black hole. Because the singularity is contained within the event horizon, where the escape velocity is the speed of light, no information can come from within it. That prevents us from measuring most properties, like temperature, composition, etc. However, there are a few properties we can measure: mass, charge, and spin. How can we measure mass? Our usual methods are at our disposal. Kepler's laws. We just need something in orbit. We can use Doppler measurements to get the orbital velocity of material in accretion disks or individual stars that may be visible. We can also see stars orbiting unseen companions, again using Kepler's laws to find the mass of the primary. If the mass is greater than 3 solar masses, we have a pretty good chance that the unseen companion is a black hole. How can we measure spin? Put simply, by measuring the distance of the innermost edge of an accretion disk from the central core. The faster the black hole spins, the closer the inner disk can get to it. If our black hole is spherical, what about pictures like this? Remember, black holes are products of relativity. Relativity defines space not in our usual 3 dimensions of height, width, and depth, but instead as 4 dimensions, our usual 3 plus the dimension of time. All 4 dimensions are fused together in what is called spacetime. The funnel diagram, like this one, is simply a 2-dimensional rendering of a 4-dimensional object. You might be wondering, what does adding the time dimension buy us? Simply put, it defines gravity not as a force, as in our 3D universe, but rather it describes space as a surface whose shape is changed by the presence of mass. It also allows time to be affected by mass in the same way as space is affected. This is known as time dilation. Relativity says the larger the mass, the greater distortion of space-time. So what if you were unlucky enough to fall in? First off, you'd die before you entered the event horizon. The strength of gravity is related to the curvature of the black hole event horizon. The more extreme the curvature, the larger the gravity gradient. The gradient is what we call tidal forces, the same forces that raise the water level on Earth's coastlines twice a day. Near the event horizon of a stellar mass black hole, the tidal forces between your feet and your head are so severe they would rip you apart. This unfortunate situation has a name: spaghettification. Yes, that's the official name.
As you get thinner and thinner and thinner, as you get closer and closer and closer, you're undergoing a process we call spaghettification, because you're basically turned into a long, thin tube of pasta.
Gravity would stretch our robotic probe to the limit, then rip it apart.
If you have a choice, the tidal forces on a large black hole are much less severe. So if you must enter one, pick the large mass black hole. You may even survive the fall past the event horizon. At least, there will be no spaghetti. So let's see what a journey into a black hole might be like.
We approach it at a reasonable distance, and we jump into the void of space. Here begins our fall. It will last about 1 hour and will be fatal to us. The spaceship remains stationed, orbiting the black hole and witnessing our fall. The stars in the background seem ever so slightly blue. We do not feel it, but the black hole distorts time, such that our clock turns slightly slower than that of distant stars. Compared to our clock, the light from the stars seems accelerated, to the extent that we see it bluer than its original color. As minutes go by, we gradually descend towards the black hole. Our speed increases and we receive the light in front of us with an increasingly high intensity, while the light behind us seems to get darker. This is the Doppler effect at play. When falling towards the black hole, we catch up with the light in front of us, while the light behind us has more difficulty reaching us. If we turned around, we would notice that the clock inside the spaceship seems to be running slower than before. The effect is subtle, but still noticeable. This is also due to the Doppler effect. If we imagine that the clock emits a signal each second, these signals take longer and longer to reach us, and we thus observe the ticking in slow motion. Minutes pass, and we gradually fly over the disk of matter. Suddenly, after 57 minutes of falling, the disk seems to fade out. We have just reached the point beyond which matter can no longer orbit the black hole steadily. The gravity is so intense that at this distance, the plasma begins to spiral very quickly into the black hole. Things will now get much faster. 2 minutes later, we are twice as close to the horizon. The passengers who remained in the spaceship see our image fade and gradually slow down until freezing on the horizon. The light that we emit takes more and more time to escape the black hole. It is received increasingly slowly and gradually fades away. The passengers will never see us cross the horizon. But for us, just 24 seconds after crossing the photon sphere, it is time to reach the horizon. After this moment, it will be impossible for us to go back. But what do we see when crossing the horizon? Surprisingly enough, nothing special. It would in fact be very difficult to determine when exactly we crossed the horizon. We still receive the light of distant stars, which falls with us. We can still see the spaceship in orbit, in which the clock, even if it seems slowed down, is still ticking. And we can still perfectly see our body, and in particular our feet, because even if all light is carried inward, it can still move upwards relative to us and thus reach our eyes. We have crossed the horizon and nothing special has happened. However, from now on, if we try to send a signal to the outside, it will never reach its destination. Below the horizon, everything is destined to fall downwards, with no hope of ever coming out. But for the moment, everything is fine. It is after another 30 seconds, just before reaching the center of the black hole, that in the blink of an eye, we feel an incredibly powerful force that stretches us until dislocating our body. This is called spaghettification. Our head being further from the center than our feet, the difference in pull is such that our body is very quickly torn apart. A tenth of a second later, the shredded remains of our body reach the center of the black hole. Our journey ends here. For the moment, modern physics cannot describe what happens this close to the center of a black hole.
Black holes fit the physics, except at the smallest scales. But can they really exist? There is one huge problem. If nothing can escape a black hole, it has no temperature. If it has no temperature, it violates a basic principle of physics, entropy. Fortunately, Stephen Hawking may have solved that problem.
According to the theory of the very tiny, in empty space, there are pairs of subatomic particles that emerge out of the void, exist for a tiny moment, and then destroy each other.
So the idea is that out of nothing, if you like, a pair of particles is created and then exists for a short time and then annihilates. And that's happening throughout space. So it's happening there, and it's happening there, and it's happening there.
This pair of particles is like yin and yang, night and day, opposites that would not exist without each other. One has positive mass, and the other has negative mass. But Hawking asked, what would happen if this pair of particles bumped up against a black hole? Hawking realized that the positive particle would have just enough energy to escape the black hole, but the particle with negative mass would fall in. And it would do something extraordinary to the black hole.
Particle that goes inside the black hole eventually decreases the mass of the black hole. It effectively has negative mass, but the particle that goes off to the distant observer is there observed as part of radiation.
Although we now understand why black holes have to give off thermal radiation, it came as a complete surprise at the time. At first, I thought I must have made a mistake.
But Hawking had not made a mistake. Around a black hole is an almost imperceptible microscopic glow. Positive mass particles fly off from it, behaving just like heat. Negative mass particles fall in. Slowly, almost imperceptibly, they decrease the mass of the black hole, and this eventually has catastrophic consequences.
So, what the Hawking result implies, it means that the black hole, instead of being black, is actually always emitting radiation. What is happening is that for most of its life, the black hole is gently sizzling away, but eventually it gets smaller and smaller, the temperature gets hotter and hotter, and eventually it gets to a point where it's so hot that it essentially explodes. It loses all the rest of its mass in a very, very short time.
So, black holes are not eternal. They radiate away at a temperature that is proportional to their mass. An Earth-sized black hole lasts for a staggering 10 to the 49th power years, and is a frigid 0.02 Kelvin. A supermassive black hole, like at the center of our Milky Way galaxy, is 10 to the minus 14 Kelvin and will last for 10 to the 99 years. In perspective, our universe is thought to be only 13.7 billion years old. That's 10 to the ninth. So we aren't in any danger of black holes evaporating anytime soon. As a final thought, if they're truly black, how can we detect them? We can measure the mass of the object in orbit around unseen companions, as we mentioned earlier. In this example, stars are orbiting the center of the Milky Way. The object at the center is estimated to be millions of solar masses, too much to be any object but a black hole in the compactness that defines this central object. Gravitational lensing is also a prediction by Albert Einstein, where gravity of a foreground object distorts the image of background objects. Here, we see 12 images of the same background galaxy. The image deflection leads to the mass of the foreground black hole. Other examples do exist, including the image of what is thought to be the first accretion disk of a black hole. Enough evidence has been found that black holes are pretty much universally accepted as true physical entities, although their true nature is yet to be determined.
Okay, picture's up. Looks like the camera's working.
That's good quality video.
Better be. It's a spare camera for the Mars rover.
How do you get your hands on that?
$1 million camera, $10 locked.
Oh my God, here he comes, this is it.
What the hell is that thing?
I don't know.
This is Dr. Sheldon Cooper. Experimental log. Wormhole generator test 44.
Wormhole generator test?
The first 43 parallel universes I've checked proved to be empty. I see no reason to suspect universe number 44 will be any different.
I found your webcam and replaced the video feed. You two should be ashamed of yourselves.